I'm Jennifer Style. I am the author of the memoir, The Woman Who Fell from the Sky, and the novel, The Ambassador's Wife. I'm here this week at Rosemont College, teaching at their MFA writing retreat. And I flew all the way from Bolivia to be here, and it has been so worth it. I love my students. It's been a really exciting week. I've learned a lot from them. I hope they've gotten a lot out of it too. There are some other incredible writers here. I would say it's a splendid way to spend a week if you're a writer.
So I'd like to welcome Jennifer Style to our little coterie of madness. And we'll ask her lots of questions about her two books, The Woman Who Fell from the Sky and The Ambassador's Wife. So once again, welcome to Friday's edition of the Rosemont Writers and Readers Series at Rosemont College, part of the Rosemont MFA program. With The Ambassador's Wife, I first want to say that this is not autobiographical. I started off with an incident that actually happened to me. I started off with a kidnapping. And it was based on something that happened to me in Yemen. But that's pretty much the only true thing in the entire book. And because I was only held for an afternoon, and I didn't want my character to just be held for an afternoon or it would be a short book. So I knew that, you know, that alone would make it different from real life. One other thing I just want to say about, like, fictionalizing things is if you're writing about something that's based on something real, you need time. Mm-hmm. You need time to separate you from the real life event. So maybe write a first draft when you're close to the event so you don't forget the details, and then look back at it later, and then later with time you're freer to screw around with it and turn it into art. Because, you know, what happened isn't art, it's life. And you have to rearrange it so it says something significant, I think, in order for it to be art. My first book was a memoir. And when I wrote my memoir, you know, my background is in journalism. And so I felt that my memoir was basically a long piece of journalism, a very long piece of journalism. But I approached it like a journalist in that I researched the heck out of everything. You know, I had Al-Qaeda experts read my pages on Al-Qaeda. I had Arabists check my Arabic transliterations. You know, I was in Yemen when I was writing it, so I could double check everything. So I was really, you know, absolutely meticulous about the facts of that story. So when I was finished with that book, I thought, I am so tired of telling the truth. All I want to do is lie about stuff and make things up and fictionalize and exaggerate and caricature people. And so it was around that time that I'd gone from living alone. I was living in Yemen at the time, gone from living alone in Yemen to moving in with my husband, who was then the British ambassador to Yemen. And going from living alone in, you know, essentially poverty, to suddenly living in the British ambassador's residence was a pretty dramatic change. And so suddenly I was living in a house where our guest rooms were full of hostage negotiators, British ministers, Scotland Yard. These are the people we had at our dinner table every night. These are the people we had breakfast with every morning. We almost always had guests. We couldn't go anywhere without bodyguards. We had armored cars. And I thought, this is so interesting. I have to write about it. I'd be at the dinner table with a little notebook under my table, like taking notes. But I didn't want to end my marriage so quickly. And I knew that if I wrote the truth about what was happening, you know, it would hurt my husband's career. And I thought, well, what about if I take this really interesting context, and put a fictional story in it? And so my fictional story just happened to start with this kidnapping. But so it takes place in a context I know very well, the Middle East, the diplomatic world, captivity. I don't know that well, thank God. But, you know, and so, but the story is completely fiction. And so I felt by the time I actually used the kidnapping scene, it was a couple years after it had happened to me. So I was removed from the kidnapping experience, and I felt free to kind of dispose of things that weren't related to the story and include things that were. So before we sat down, turned the camera on, I was asking you a little bit about the non-linear structure of the novel, and I was wondering if maybe you'd talk about some of your decisions about why you decided to write the book that way.
I'm not sure I was capable of writing it in any other way, to be honest. I mean, I started off trying to write it linearly, but I keep having ideas. Basically, writing occurs to me in scenes. I have little scenes would occur in my head, and I would have a vision of a scene. Pretty early on in the process, I had a vision of a scene that happens towards the end of the book. And I can't just ignore that scene. I have to write it down or I'll lose it. So I would write that scene, and then I'd have a, and then that scene would necessitate something to happen earlier on. And so I would write, I think of working on it as almost a little bit, I've got a bunch of different metaphors for this, but kind of like doing quilting squares. So each scene was a quilting square, and then I would, here's where the mixed metaphor comes in, where I shuffle them like cards. So it's almost like each scene is a playing card, and then I kind of put them all out on the table and move them around. And so I had them in an order that made sense to me, and then my agent said, it's slightly clearer if you shuffle them this way. And then my editor said, it's slightly clearer if we put them this way. And they were right. And so it kind of, it evolved. But basically, I didn't write it linearly. I wrote it in scenes. It takes place basically in two different times, you know, in the time of her captivity onward, and then from when she moved to the country to the time of her captivity, and you go back and forth between those two times. But sometimes something that happened in captivity would mean I had to write a scene that took place earlier about something in her life. And I might not know that I had to write that earlier scene until I wrote the later scene, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, no, it totally makes sense. It totally does.
So, from a global perspective, women are not in a good place. And, you know, I was really interested in the women. I mean, I was very inspired by the women that worked with me in Yemen. And that they lived in this incredibly difficult environment, and just the ways in which they were strong and they persevered, and the ways they had to fight for things that we take for granted, like being able to go to school or get an education. There's an old joke about Yemen, told to any traveler who sticks around long enough. Noah came back to Earth recently, curious to see how it had evolved since his time. In a private jet on loan from God, he first flew over France and said, "My, look at France, how it's changed. What exciting new architecture. What amazing innovation." He then flew over Germany. Incredible, I'd hardly recognize it. So much new technology, such thrilling industry. And then he headed to Southern Arabia. "Ah, Yemen," he said fondly. "I'd know it anywhere. Hasn't changed a bit." In many ways, it hasn't. Of course, I wasn't in Yemen back in the first millennium BC, when Noah's son Shem is said to have founded the capital city of Sana'a. But in many parts of the country, people are living exactly as their ancestors did thousands of years ago. They herd goats and cows. They grow wheat, pomegranates, and grapes. They travel long distances to fetch water. They live in simple square mud brick homes. They paint themselves with naqsh for weddings. They pray. The ancient landscape reveals little evidence of the passage of time. On a flyover today, Noah would find that erosion has run light fingers over the jagged mountains of the central highlands. Long stretches of empty beaches in the south are touched by the same tides that have washed them since the flood. In the east, desert sands shift in barely perceptible ways. The green terraces carved into the Haraz Mountains in the west, or the hills around Ibn Taiz to the south, may have been there since the dawn of agriculture, cultivated by generation after generation of Yemeni farmers. The dense vegetation of the valley suggests the whim of a playful god who, weary of the relentless beige of Arabian rock and sand, tossed a thick emerald quilt over Yemen's countryside, creating a fertile layer that has fed the Yemeni people for generations. Noah would find the most familiar territory in the country's remotest places, such as the island of Socotra, located 220 miles off Yemen's eastern coast. On Socotra, there are few roads and fewer electric lights. The dominant structures are not the crumbling stone buildings, which blend so completely into the hillsides that you don't see them until you trip over a small child running out of one, but its fanciful dragon's blood trees,
their tall 1,000-year-old trunks erupting in such a wild tangle of branches that they resemble a forest of umbrellas blown upward by the wind. Many Socotri people still live in caves, where they boil tea over fires in a corner to serve with goat milk still warm from their animals. Their dining rooms are thin woven mats spread outside their doors where they eat fish stew and with chewy flatbread under salty night skies. There are people on Socotra who have no idea what happened on September 11th, 2001 in America. There are no radio stations and almost no one can read. Everything they know, they have heard from neighbors, imams, or the occasional foreign aid worker. Britney Spears does not exist here. Hollywood is meaningless. Ice cream would not survive. There is almost no refrigeration. Many of Yemen's mainland villages feel just as remote, tucked along a mountain ridge or at the edge of a stretch of desert. These villages get their news from state-controlled television or from the mosque. Only the elite would pick up a newspaper or read a book. But what use is news of the outside world to these people? Will it help their crops to grow? Will it keep their goats free from disease? Will it bring them closer to God? No? Well then. Yemen has not only kept herself looking much the same as she did in Noah's time, but she also wears the same perfume she did when she was young. Cruising at a lower altitude, Noah would smell frankincense, the fragrant resin that put Yemen on the map for traders 4,000 years ago and is still burned as incense. The acrid sweat of laboring men and rayon-wrapped women. The purple and white jasmine flowers that proliferate in its lush lowlands, and the smoke of wood fires warming bread ovens. In her cities, these odors mingle with the smell of frying beans and jalapenos, fenugreek-flavored meat stews, tobacco smoke, and roasted lamb, while the countryside is fragrant with overtones of manure and ripening bananas, dates, and mangoes. Following those scents earthward, Noah would soon glimpse clusters of boxy brown houses, their roofs strewn with airing carpets and drying laundry. Through the maze of streets hurry men on their way to the mosque, women selling flat discs of bread, and children chasing a ball. Sana'a is one of the oldest cities in the Arabian Peninsula and in the world. Built at least 2,500 years ago, it was once home to Sabaean kings and Himyarite rulers. Islam arrived in the 7th century AD, rearranging the face of the city. Many of the buildings erected during the time of the Prophet Muhammad are still standing, though crumbling a bit around the edges. The great mosque of Sana'a was built under the instructions of the Prophet himself, according to local legend. It is not only the biggest, but the most famous mosque in the old city, Sana'a al-Qadima. It contains a large library and a host of ancient manuscripts. More than 100 other mosques now populate the old city, a fact that is particularly evident during the calls to prayer. No matter where you stand, you feel as if you're directly underneath a mosque loudspeaker. The muezzins drown out conversations and make it impossible to listen to music, which of course is the point. Prayer is the only appropriate activity at these times. When Allah's messengers talk, you should be listening. No modern buildings mar the ancient aesthetic of the old city, which was declared a UNESCO World Heritage Site in 1984. It probably looks much the same as it did thousands of years ago. Noah would definitely recognize it. This is Yemen yesterday. This is Yemen today. The next day, my third day at work, we close my first issue. It takes 19 hours. Yet I'm not unhappy, even with the overwhelming amount of work to do. The thing about being at the top of the masthead is that there's never any question of leaving early or leaving anything undone. I find something very comforting about succumbing to this total commitment. It eliminates all other choices. I'm going to make this a better paper or die trying. I have nothing else to distract me. I'm free of an intimate relationship, having just ended a turbulent on-again, off-again romance in New York. I haven't time to socialize outside of work. I have no other deadlines. I can give this paper everything. I will have to. I wake at 6 a.m. and walk to work. Men stare at me as I pass. It's unusual to see a woman walking alone, particularly one with blue eyes and uncovered hair. But their comments are mostly benign. Everywhere I go, I'm showered with "Welcome to Yemen's" and "I love you." I stopped covering my hair after I realized it made no difference the amount of attention I attracted, and because Yemenis kept asking me, "Why do you cover your hair? You're a Westerner." The morning's deliciously cool and crisp. Sinanis are not early risers, so the streets don't get busy till close to 11 a.m. When the women get in, I consult with Zuhra, who's fast becoming my right-hand woman, and send Najma and Noor to cover a Japanese flower arranging demonstration. Hardly real news, but it's a nice, easy way to break them in and get them used to reporting outside of the office. I have to send them together so that neither has to travel alone in a car with a man. It can damage a woman's reputation to be seen alone in a taxi with a male driver. There is no Yemen Observer driver available, so I have to wheedle the taxi fare out of the doctor, who vigorously resists all attempts to draw down his allotment of rials. The doctor. Everyone lives in terror of this tall, bespectacled man who is not actually a doctor, but the person in charge of administration and finance. He doles out salaries, takes attendance every morning, and serves as Ferris's iron fist of enforcement. The doctor never speaks. He shouts. He shouts at Ines, the secretary. He shouts at my reporters. And inevitably, he shouts at me. Shouting in the newsroom does not always suggest displeasure, however. Many of the men shout as a matter of course. Often I run out of my office thinking I'm overhearing a fierce argument when really what the men are saying to each other is, "Fantastic new car you have! Where did you get it? Hey, do you want some of this? God, it's delicious!" But when the doctor shouts, it generally means trouble. So far he's trying to be nice to me, so I get the taxi money for the women. I have to talk to Ferris about providing transportation for our reporters. They don't have enough money to pay for these things themselves. I'm amazed that Ferris fails to provide his staff with so many essentials. My reporters are not given business cards, telephones, or press IDs, and are even required to buy their own notebooks and pens. But they cannot afford these things on their salaries of $100 to $200 a month. No wonder they make a notebook last for weeks. I buy a stack of notebooks for them. I'd buy them phones too, but my salary doesn't extend that far. I spent the morning editing the Panorama page, a collection of editorials from other Yemeni papers, and Najma's article about a course that trains women to manage money. It's an interesting story, but she hasn't talked with any of the women at the workshop other than the instructor. You should have talked with a minimum of 15 women who participated in the workshop, I say. Their personal stories are what would make this really interesting. It's too late for this issue. I have to let a lot of things slide in this first issue. But Najma seems to understand, so it's a start. I write and edit all day with no break save for the 20 minutes I spend walking to the Jordanian sandwich shop with Zuhra. "You need to take a breath," she says. Back at the office, Zuhra helps me figure out which pages are missing stories. Farouk still hasn't turned up, so we have nothing for the front or local pages. I try not to panic. I ring Ibrahim at his home office to ask him about the election page, and he sends over two stories, promising a third by noon. Al-Assadi promises at least one front-page story. Clearly, we need more staff. Luke swings around my door jamb toward lunch, flushed with excitement. "Did you hear?" he said. "The crocodile hunter died." "No." "Steve Irwin?" "Yeah." "What killed him? A crocodile?" "Stingray. Right through the heart." "Jesus. So, front page?" "Perfect. We have nothing else." "Well, it's definitely of global significance." Luke pops into my office often to chat or trade stories. A half an hour later, he walks in holding an enormous jar of amber liquid. "I just accidentally bought $30 worth of honey," he says. "Accidentally?" "Well, I was with Al-Assadi, and there was this guy he usually gets his honey from, so I ordered some too, but I didn't realize it would be this big, or that it would cost $30. He looks forlornly at the enormous jar in his hand. "I have enough honey to last me a year." "Well," I say, "I guess you better learn to bake." "You don't bake with Yemeni honey. It's too special for that." "It can't be really good Yemeni honey," says Zuhra, who's just walked in. "If it were really good honey, it would have cost you $80 at least." Later in the afternoon, Al-Assadi pops his head into our office. "How about we don't have a front page this issue? What do you think?" I shrug. "I can live without it." But the banter hides a growing panic. The later it gets, the more we shuffle stories from page to page. We don't have enough local stories, so I suggest we move a story on the back page to the local page, and that I quickly write the story in the boutique exhibit to replace the back page. It's infinitely easier to churn out a story myself than to rewrite one of theirs. I feel some guilt over this, but not much. It's just one story. Zuhra leaves work around 3 p.m., as she and the other women must be home before dark. She's distressed to leave me on my own, worried I will never survive without her.
I'll be fine, I say with a complete lack of conviction. We just might not have our front page. She looks at me with concern. Do you maybe need to swim? She says. I laugh. Not today, I say, gesturing toward the stack of pages waiting to be edited. Tomorrow. Al-Assadi returns from a long lunch around 4 p.m. and throws a handful of cut next to my computer. This will help, he says. My energy flagging, I follow his lead. The cut tastes extra bitter and the shiny leaves are hard to chew, but I imagine that Al-Assadi knows where to buy the best cut, so I assume it's a good vintage. It must be, given how much I immediately perk up. With newfound vigor, I whip out a 955-word story in the batik exhibit in less than an hour. No wonder everyone loves this drug. I file the story and run upstairs to choose photos with Mas, the precocious 19-year-old photographer. When I return, a pile of new things to edit is waiting on my desk. Ibrahim's election stories are thin. Everything I edit ends up half its original length. My reporters repeat themselves ad nauseum. Around 10 p.m., when I finally start to crash from the cot, dinner arrives. We all eat outside in the courtyard, standing around a table piled with roti, Yemeni baguettes, and places of fasulia, beans, eggs, fool, cheese, and tea. We fall upon the food like a pack of wolves. I'm the last to leave the table, reluctantly, with a fistful of bread. My energy is back. Good thing, too, given how much is still left to do. The flash drive passing between me and Luke accelerates. I edit the stories, then he edits them, then I see them again on the page, then he sees them one last time. I don't take a step out of the building from the time I get there at 8:30 until the time I leave in the early hours of the following morning. Yet I'm so busy that the day feels short. So many times in those first few weeks, when my reporters come to me with a question, I instinctively think I should run it by someone in charge. But slowly, it begins to sink in that the only person responsible for these decisions is me. Miraculously, by 3 a.m., we have a front page, and a local page, and an election page, a health page, a reports page, and panorama, and Middle East, and op-ed. In fact, we have an entire newspaper. We all high-ten each other and say, Mabruk, congratulations. I am briefly euphoric before a terrifying thought occurs to me. We have to do it all over again, starting in about 6 hours. A single ray of sunlight streaming in through a tiny square cut into the roof of Miranda's Diwan caught the dusty air, exposing the glittering powder with which the women filled their lungs. Atoms of stone exhaled centuries ago that had drifted out windows and down narrow passageways, in and out of mosques, in and out of Mizruki mouths, male and female, adult and child, believer and heretic, sharing breath. Miranda contemplated the light, the tumbling grit, tempted to dry out her own sketchbook. Pieces of the universe as old as God rained down on them. She sat on the floor at the end of the rectangular room, charcoal pencils and pastels fanned out in front of her. The women were still floating onto the cushions, abayas sinking down around them like parachutes, two on either side. Akila and Nadia on her left, Taskia and Miriam on her right. Their faces were bare, niqabs flipped back over their heads. As Miranda shuffled through a stack of sketchbooks on her lap, they unzipped bags, curled their bare feet underneath them, and lifted their eyes to her, hopeful, wary, eager, anxious. They had been meeting for several weeks. Each time, the women were incrementally more relaxed, more confident, but it was slow. Their fears were too well-founded to be vanquished entirely. In her first class, as if to make sure Miranda understood what they risked, they had told her, in turns, interrupting each other in their imperfect English, the tale of Isla. Instinctively, the girls who doodled in the margins of their school notebooks were drawn to each other and formed a kind of protective secret society. Taskia, Akila, and Mariam had met as children, scribbling with their fingers in the dust of the alleys near their homes until adult arms finally descended to restrain them. Nadia and Isla, who came from villages in the north, had moved to the city later as teenagers. Rarely did they meet all together, afraid of discovery. But in pairs, they encouraged each other, rationalized away their sins, offered the comfort of shared guilt. Isla had been among the boldest, sketching caricatures of their teachers and friends, which she shared only with her fellow artists before tearing them into confetti or setting fire to them in an unpopulated alley. When her father discovered one such drawing on the back page of a textbook, he had taken Isla by the hand without speaking and led her to the room where her mother was ironing their sheets. "Go," he'd said to his wife. "I have a lesson to teach your daughter." As soon as the woman was out of sight, Isla's father had turned the iron on its side and stood behind the girl, holding her wrists. With slow deliberation, he had pressed her palms against the scorching metal. Her mother had responded immediately to her daughter's screams, but had been unable to pull her husband's arms away. Isla had been hospitalized with third-degree burns for 13 days before she died of septicemia. The story had a dampening effect on Miranda's professorial passion. While she hadn't been cavalier in inviting the women to study with her, she had insufficiently grasped the peril in which she placed them. Never had such a responsibility been laid on her shoulders. Yet, here they were. Four hungry souls gathered before her, their passion overwhelming their terror. Did this not have to be honored? Knowing what they dared, how could she not teach them? She holds out the soggy shirt to Aisha. "Milk," she says. "I have a baby at home." Perhaps this information will encourage leniency. Surely a woman would understand what it means to be separated from a child. Aisha stares for a moment and then reaches her left hand toward the shirt. She pinches it and lets it drop. "Milk," she says. "Son or daughter?" "A daughter." Miranda isn't sure she should be giving this information away, but she cannot think of anything else to say. She pulls the jersey over her head. The woman clucks again in disapproval. "Maybe next time you'll have a son," she says. Miranda bites back an instinctual defense of her daughter. When she was pregnant, the guards had constantly blessed her belly, wishing her a boy. But Miranda had wanted a girl for as long as she wanted a child at all. After the amniocentesis in London, when she and Finn had told the guards they were definitely having a girl, the men still resisted the idea. This is not a country that rejoices at the birth of girls. "Inshallah, it will be a boy," they repeated. Miranda and Finn tried to explain that they already knew the child's sex, but this just confused the men. Finally, Miranda gave up, though she could never resist saying, "But I don't want a boy. I want a girl." It was important to her to know that they know that somewhere, by someone, girls were wanted. Aisha adjusts her niqab one more time and disappears. Miranda assumes she's gone to fetch her something else to wear, but when the woman returns a few hours later, she's carrying a tiny parcel wrapped in a dirty pink blanket. "You feed," she says. "Feed her." She thrusts the blanket toward Miranda, who gingerly takes it in her hands. It weighs almost nothing. In the dim light, it takes her a second to discern the top of a tiny head covered with fine black hair. Kneeling, Miranda lays the baby on the floor in front of her and slowly peels back the blanket. Nausea wrings her stomach when she sees the tiny infant. Its ribs are clearly visible, propping up the skin like tent poles, its arms and legs wasted almost to bone. Its stomach is bloated and round. Miranda slips a finger around the edge of the filthy piece of cloth pinned at the tiny hips. A girl. The child watches her with large dark eyes, quiet. She doesn't have the energy to cry, Miranda thinks. It may be too late. Aisha is watching her impatiently. She flips the blanket closed again, covering the child's shriveled form. "Feed," she says again. "Where's her mother?" "Maita, dead." "And her father?" "They were both killed. Government bombs." "She has no one?" "No one is left." Miranda lifts the featherweight child, shifting her into her left arm as she lifts her shirt with her right hand. Queasiness at her disloyalty almost overwhelms her. But chubby little Cressida doesn't need this anymore, even if she could get it to her. She presses the child's face to her nipple, but the tiny girl doesn't drink. She simply continues to stare up at Miranda, her cracked lips slightly open.